sure and people are curious about those things.
When I heard about Darley's case, it didn't take me long to make up my mind that this was something that needed to be followed. And so I wanted to go see for myself. I was in the courtroom during the entire trial, which was 5 weeks long. You would walk into the courtroom. Over to the right was Darley and her team, and to the left, facing them, were the jury.
At the time of the trial, I was 32 years old, and the day I got picked for this jury, I found out I was pregnant the same day. It was the first time I'd ever even been called to jury duty, and the first time I get picked at the murder trial. I just knew that she was young and that she had, killed her boys.
And no other person is the individual who stabbed and murdered her own children as they lay sleeping in their own home. The judge asked me to call my first witness, and I chose to call the medical examiner who had performed the autopsy. When you try a jury trial, you're trying it on many different levels. You're trying it on an intellectual level, but you're also trying it on an emotional level. I wanted the jury to see the suffering that this poor child had gone through, because not only had this child been stabbed, but these were four deep, penetrating stab wounds to his back. And that jury needed to understand the fury and the rage and the force that had been used to murder that child. That was important to us. It was part of our strategy in this particular case.
There was a lot of stab wounds on both of those boys, and that's a lot of blood. A lot of blood.
We also wanted them to see how different the children's injuries were from what they were going to learn about the defendant's injuries.
So we also called Dr. Santos, who was the head emergency room surgeon that treated Darley Battier. I asked him to describe the lady's turn, how serious the throat wound was, and he said it was a superficial one. They had just cut the skin, and I just had to suture it up. With any amount of force at all, a sharp knife will cut through your throat. Here, the doctors testify, just cut the upper skin. You look at the injuries to the boys, they were impaled. Deep stab wounds that went through their entire chest and back area, through the body.
The piece of the doctor's testimony that stood out the most was that there were no life-threatening wounds. They were superficial and possibly even self-inflicted.
Because we don't have a live witness to contradict the story that Darley Rettier's been telling up to this point. What we're going to have to rely upon is the physical evidence in the crime scene to do that for us.
When you have a circumstantial evidence case, then it's all live. Little piece of evidence that prove her guilt.
And so we called James Cron. James Cron had been asked by the Round Up Police Department to assist them in processing the crime scene. His testimony was to start showing this jury how this crime scene does not match up with the defendant's story. What he testified to was this: a lack of blood on the couch where the defendant said she was attacked. Her bloody footprints are underneath broken glass. And then there's no indication whatsoever that anyone either entered or exited out that window. Also, James Cron told the Rowlett Police Department that they should collect every single knife in that home. And so they collected, in addition to the murder weapon, a bread knife that was found in the kitchen. Charles Lynch, a forensic expert, looked at it microscopically and had it analyzed. He found two particles on the bread knife. One, he found fiberglass rods. Secondly, he found a rubbery compound. Why is that important? Because we go back to the screen that's been cut by this supposed intruder. What is the screen made?